A trip through the Austrian wine country of South Styria is certainly one of the most beautiful experiences. Seductive nature, places of history, and highly cultivated viticulture make the wine routes a dream destination for a round trip. Echternhausen is the gateway to the South Styrian wine route, a small town with a history, protected by a castle that was temporarily owned by the Habsburgs. In the center, there is the Church of Pilgrims, the sorrowful Mother Mary. Several statues adorn the high altar, which was built into the choir enclosure, complemented by richly pictorial ceiling paintings. And cherubs and stone gravestones pay homage to the builders. At the transition of the facade to the tower, the stone sculptures are unmistakably of Rococo style. A steep path leads directly from the center of the village up to the mausoleum of Ruprecht von Eggenberg, which is part of his ancestral castle. His financial difficulties and early death meant a long construction period resulting in various stylistic influences. The noble family Eggenberg inherited the castle and surroundings in as early as 1543. Opposite is the yellow 19th century Gorgi Castle, built by Count Atoms in the English Tudor style. Southern Styria is like a garden full of delicacies. A small natural paradise with gentle green hills, lovely valleys, and wine. The high quality of the vines cultivated here is well known, and the arrangement of the vineyards allows comparisons to the Italian region of Tuscany. Traveling here is like a feast for the senses. Gamlitz is the largest wine-growing community in this region. More than 2,000 years ago, Celts lived here, and later the Romans, who began to cultivate vines. During times of migration, much deteriorated, but with Christianization, reclamation, and viticulture, a revival took place. The church and especially the monasteries were key participants in the development and expansion of viticulture in the Middle Ages. The Turks repeatedly invaded and caused great damage to the vineyards, but the wine growers rebuilt them nonetheless. And so a landscape was created that is often called the Styrian Kingdom of Heaven. Wine growing received a great boost from Archduke Johann. In order to find the most suitable varieties, he had vines from all parts of the world planted. Ratsch was mentioned in the 11th century as rats. The Urbani Chapel is relatively young, built in honor of the patron saint of viticulture. At harvest time, everyone lends a hand. The ripe grapes are cut from the vine by hand and carried in containers to the collection truck, which takes them to the press. Another day ends in satisfaction. The value of old winegrowers' farmsteads has been recognized. So too Kastenberg, a building from 1638 that was only revived in 2021. And the old wine cellar preserved. The Klapotis Street got its name after the landmark of South Styria, a rattling wooden scarecrow. The rhythmic clatter of the wooden windmill is meant to keep the birds away from the vineyards, who might otherwise nibble away at the sweet grapes. A Klapotis must have a beat board made of stone fruit wood. When one of the eight wings beats on it, it produces a high-frequency sound that the birds cannot bear. The largest glass grape can also be found on the Eyrarkogl. Leutschach is the current capital of the Styrian vineyards and looks back on a long tradition of trade. As early as 1421, the town was granted market rights, and the market square dates back to the 17th century. Catholic parish church was built over a first church dating from 1200 and dedicated to St. Nicholas, the protector of travelers and merchants. The high altarpiece, two side altars and the huge stained glass windows were transferred from one church to the other. Others date from the turn of the century. In the modern renovated town hall, right next to the church, the wine gallery tells of the painstaking work of the wine growers. Among the well-preserved houses on the main square, the oldest is the Trappenberg. The Keneally house is also old and dates back to around 1700. It served as a residential building, later as a restaurant, and also as a cinema. Some rooms were lavishly renovated. This made it possible to restore the magnificent paintings, whose motifs also often refer to the history of the place. Today, in addition to a cafe, it also houses a cultural center and music school, which make an important contribution to the community. The Klapotis Street ends in Arnfels. The old village center proudly displays its townhouses and the small bridge with a statue of a saint. Around 1450, the chapel Zur Heiligen Maria am Krunenwasen was built on the banks of the Posnitz, there where an image of Mary was washed ashore. At the end of the 17th century, the chapel was declared a Protestant church and later, during the course of the Counter-Reformation, became a Catholic place of worship again. The main Baroque work is the columned high altar from 1728 with large gilded carved figures. The oldest pieces of equipment are 8 funerary monuments which have been preserved as relics of the old church. The stones, relief panels, and back walls date from the 16th century. From here, several hiking trails lead to the hills that form the border with Slovenia, or to the Eichberg in the north, right through the vineyards. And the trip to the castle above the village is always worthwhile, as the views certainly reward the effort. The castle itself is not open to visitors, but the exterior looks well maintained. Here, all roads lead to wine. Likewise, the Rebenland wine route. In idyllic villages and between vineyards lie the wineries in Buschenschanken, sort of wine taverns. An enchanting sea of hills, a postcard landscape of vineyards. First everything glows in fresh green and then slowly changes into shades of bright red and yellow. Along the roads and paths, there are many typical Buschenschanken, those are the wine taverns, in the region that serve their own wine and usually offer cold specialities from Styria. Somewhere to comfortably sit together, often in the midst of the vineyards, and enjoy the natural products. If red roses are planted in a vineyard, then this refers to red wine. We visit such a wine farm which has been adapted to the needs of the present times. Besides wine growing and processing, rooms are also available to rent. An old wine cellar has also been preserved, where visitors can marvel at various wine-making equipment from the early days. And with a bit of luck, the old farmer from the Köllerhof will explain how in the past wine was made with simple equipment. Mashing, that is separating the grapes from the stalk and crushing them. And then pressing, that is the pressing out of the mash. Then sulfuration, and finally fermentation, ripening and storage. And right next door is an example of how wine is processed today with modern equipment. In 1994, an attraction was erected on the Kreuzberg, a wooden observation tower that can be climbed via 117 steps. From 663 meters above sea level, The view of the southern Styrian wine country is overwhelming. A cultural landscape whose charm is extraordinary and unmistakable. The excavations at Frauenberg near Leibniz are amongst the most important archaeological sites in Styria. Upon this Roman temple hill, a Celtic palace of power was founded, a late ancient burial ground and a temple in honor of a Greco-Roman goddess. Excavations continued at the forecourt of the Isis temple, and fragments of pottery, bronze, and silver coins and bones are still being unearthed. From up here, there's a view into a large ensemble of buildings. It is Segal Castle, perched on a wooded hill above the town of Leibniz. In the 12th century, with the colonization of southern Styria in mind, the archbishops of Salzburg built their first bastion for their missionaries and their administration here. From 1218 onwards, the bishops of Seckau expanded the complex. The view from the castle reaches down into the village of Leibniz and further into the Sulm Valley. Later in time, three neighboring castles evolved here. The castle of Leibniz in the possession of the Salzburg archbishops, the castle of the bishops of Seckau, and Polheim Castle. The three buildings were eventually connected with the Baroque castle chapel, the Michael's Chapel, a lapidarium, the princely rooms, and the bishop's gallery. The fusion happened when the Diocese of Seckau assumed control and the name was changed to Segal. Valuable cultural treasures could be restored and thus preserved. This was achieved with the help of some economic collaboration. In parts of the complex, a conference hotel combined with a great restaurant was established. There was also a special educational establishment nearby, the Silberberg Viticulture School, with its Styrian fruit and wine nature path. This is a place where future fruit and wine specialists can be trained. Everything from responsible work practice in nature to processing and finally marketing is taught. The control of the dangers from pests in fruit and wine growing is also covered. And the handling of different grape varieties is not only explained in theory, but supervised here in practice. The significance of the Clapotets is also explained, not only as a landmark, but also as a meaningful tradition to protect the grapes. The Sausal wine route is the last of this tour and leads up through the Sulm Valley, past steep vineyards with overflowing hanging grapes. And breathtaking natural scenery. This wine route becomes secondary to the landscape as it gently meanders up and over the green hills until we reach our destination, Kitzek in Sausal. The Catholic parish church was completed in 1644. The carving of the Pietà on the high altar is well known. This was created in the Rococo style towards the end of the 18th century. After a fire, a new tower was built in 1835. The view from up here makes the landscape with all its shades of green seem almost like a painting. The first Styrian wine museum is located in a wine grower's house from the early 18th century, was extended in 1910, and is now a listed building. The old press house from 1726 displays household goods of the peasants and corresponding old tools for wine growing and processing in former times. The equipment, pictures and photos invoke nostalgia, but it's also clear that viticulture has always meant hard work. The rooms were cosily furnished for the winter season as the wine growers and their families had to spend a lot of time here. It was a quiet time when people wove, knitted, or carved to make ends meet with a small sideline. The signpost of this route shows figures in traditional costume set upon a clapotes. At 546 meters, Kitzek is the highest wine-growing village in Europe. Up here, the village street winds its way along the crest of the hill. On both sides of the slope, the vineyards are laid out with geometric precision to take full advantage of their pre-planned exposure to the sun, and so allow the grapes to reach their famous degree of ripeness. This is also helped by the soils with their old slate and primary rock. Such an atmospheric setting is a good place to rest, and the roasted chestnuts which also grow here provide tasty supplements to the wine. Finally, we visit the largest clapotes in the world. The special climate and the calcareous soils of this region favors the cultivation of vines. This adventure trip along the wine routes has shown that wine has always influenced history and culture.